firstly, thank you for having me here today. And to be honest, this is something that I have been talking about a lot, but I haven't put it on a PPT and never talked about it in general. So I'll introduce myself again. I hold a bachelor's degree from Lady Shri Ram College for Women. Unfortunately, I am not a science student, much to the chagrin of my parents. But what I can talk to you today about is the fact that I've been a journalist for the last 4.5, almost 5 years. And around 5 years back, I came back from the London School of Economics, like every other graduate from a premier institute abroad. I had dreams to like change the landscape of media and change the landscape of journalism. And there were some experiences that I had that changed my view of how journalism works. And it made me realize that there are a lot of things that are wrong with digital media. And there are a lot of things that we don't know that is wrong. We know the things like fake news. We know stuff like the fact that people write catchy headlines, but we don't know the depths, how deep the problems go. Why do we need fair media organizations? Why do we need places that are objective? So I think I left my, if someone can give it to me. So I've titled this, What's Wrong with Digital Media in India? Because we know what's wrong with print. We know what's wrong with broadcast media. We know what's wrong with Arnab Goswami. So I'm not going to get into that. So we obviously know about clickbaity headlines. You must have seen these kind of headlines. And I'm sure all of you must have clicked on one of these in your lifetime. The problem with these things is that there's a lot of pressure on media organizations to get the numbers. So when you work at a media organization, when I was working at digital media organizations, the biggest pressure that came on us was to get numbers. So write headlines that have like these, like, you know, catchy stuff. Like, remember this fat kid. It's very problematic in the sense that, first of all, there's objectification of women that really works. And there's this massive massive audience in tier two cities, tier three cities, who want to read such stuff. And the problem is it's increasing because we are not doing anything about it. This is what we feed people. This is what they want to read. That's the cycle. So when you see websites like Times of India, other big publications like Hindustan Times, and other smaller media outlets, I will not take names, but you see them quoting these huge numbers. We have these many annual visits, like monthly visits on our website. We have these many, you know, users reading our stuff. You know, we get so many clicks on one article. How do they get those numbers? Have you ever thought about it? That's because there is this parallel life, this parallel website that always runs on the side where they get the numbers from that place. That's the place where you have the clickbaity headlines. That's the place you have the listicles. That's the place you have, you publish articles in a parallel universe. I'll just show it to you on the next slide. So the reason listicles became popular is because there was a study that was done in which it was discovered that users read articles in an F fashion. So they have a very short attention span. So they look for like main things in an article and then they lose their attention. So they mostly read like 20% of an article, which is why publications like The Guardian have to beg people for contribution, because nobody wants to read like good stuff. People just want to read the short stuff and get away with it. So yeah, listicles is basic. Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't explain. So listicles are articles which you have, where you have like lists. So these are very these are popularized by Scoop, Poop and BuzzFeed. Like 10 things to do when you wake up in the morning. Scoop, Poop and BuzzFeed are like these youth websites which have become very popular among the millennial generation. So they mostly have like a lot of, they focus a lot on lifestyle and we focus a lot on like youth issues and everything, which is why they became very, very popular at one point of time. Right now, BuzzFeed is laying off a lot of employees because they don't have funding and they're not getting the number of views that they require to survive. Yeah, so I'll be getting to that a little later. So most of the people who access articles on social media primarily are people between the ages of 15 to 20. And they're also the least able to understand what is fake news, what is not fake news. That is where the problem is. And most of the youth, 15 to 20, yes. And most of the people who come on these websites come from tier 2, tier 3 cities. And there's a lot of, the problem is that when you publish these kind of articles, when you give people fake news, there are also these platforms where you can go write articles, where you can go share things. And there's a lot of hate that flows around. There's a lot of angst that is there amongst young people. And these websites capitalize on these things, write about these things, and we read them as news. So there, a lot of you must have heard of incidents where people were lynched, mob lynched, because there were articles that came out on WhatsApp about fake articles that this person is, you know, this Hindu girl is running away with this Muslim boy. So then a crowd comes and just lynches people. So these are the problems that are coming up, but we are not doing anything about it. And I'll get into the capitalist side of things. Why is this happening? Why do we have publications writing articles like, okay, 10 actresses you need to watch out for in the next 10 years or something? So there's a fight for investment. It would be great if you can ask after the slide. There's a fight for investment. We all know about the startup culture. People are burning money like crazy, and there's not much funding. And these are some quotes from real life situations I have faced at the workplace. So investors want us to get more numbers, get our Alexa rank down. Alexa is this website where you can check your website rank. And it's very, very important because that also affects your Google searches. So if you're at the top of the Alexa rankings, then you pop up on Google much more. Your articles come up much more. When you have these like search engine optimization terms, like, you know, say I search UPSC and you've written an article on UPSC, your rank is number one. Your article will come on top even if it's absolute bullshit. So that's how things work. So I was in this situation where we were initially trying to make a website like where we were talking about hardcore news, hardcore opinion articles. Then we one day pivoted to listicles. One fine morning, we woke up and we were told, no, we're not getting numbers. Now everybody will write like lists, okay, 10 things to do, 10 lifestyle articles, health articles, because people want to read that. I don't know if people want to read that, but we are making people believe that they want to read that. Then I was in another situation where we were told, okay, let's get a team of 4 to 5 people to work back end on these things. So they are going to be the back end team. They are going to get us the numbers. And then we have a front end team that will publish the front end articles, which you will see on our website when you open it. So you will see like the good stuff, like what the liberals say, the fine stuff. And it does work. The strategy did work. There was this one particular website that had an Alexa rank of 900 and it went down to 170. This is the kind of stuff that actually sells over the web, and this is the kind of stuff that people read. And unfortunately, these are the kind of headlines, these are the kind of captions that people read about. And I'll tell you that there's a timeline to post these articles. So usually after 10 in the night till like 4 in the morning. That's when people come on these social media websites. I'm sure you must have seen it on various social media web pages, on Facebook or Twitter, when after 10 in the night, you see such articles and you click on it. And people read it. And there's also a lot of pressure on journalists to come up with like appropriate like these kind of pictures. So if you can see that all these designs that have been made, these pictures that we have been picked up from popular media, because a lot of times people click on articles just after looking at the picture, even if the picture is highly inappropriate, but people do click. And people do comment, and that's how things work. That's how we have to show the numbers. What happens when you don't have the numbers and in turn you don't have the investment? What do people do? Either you overwork your staff, which is what a lot of digital media organizations do. There are people who have no holidays. They work 7 days a week. You have to be you're overworked, and there are a lot of people out there who are there to take your jobs because there are so many graduates in media. You do it or you get fired. There's a lot of pressure on journalists. You have to write catchy headlines. You have to explore corporate tie-ups. So where you have campaign articles, where you have a tie-up with, say, Philips to write an article about air conditioners or something like that, or air purifiers. And when you talk about, at the end of the articles, you say, okay, so Philips has this air purifier, which you can buy for this thing. And then you say, sponsored by Philips. The problem is, at the end of the day, people are still coming to your website because they want to read news. And you're marketing yourself as a place where, you know, I sell good news, I sell the good stuff, I'm not like rubbish websites. But at the end of the day, this is what people have to do to get the numbers. There are also instances where we have inflated numbers in front of investors to tell them that, okay, we are getting these many numbers, but you cannot, and the employees are told to not expose the real numbers, because obviously if the real numbers are out, then they'll not get funding. It is a situation of absolute desperation. There's also situations where if there's a website that's being run by one person who's particularly popular, that person wants to maintain his or her popularity. So when there is one editor who writes an article that does really well, that founder goes away and takes away credit because they want to be the face. So at the end of the day, journalism is not about serving the people, it's about serving yourself. That's the first thing that is the biggest problem with digital media. This is one article I had to unfortunately write when I was working as a journalist. I'm sorry to say this, but I could not exercise my own judgment, because when you are working as journalists, you have to do certain things because you are given no other option. You either do it or you get fired. And these are commercial campaigns that get the money for a lot of websites that do not want to go through that route of publishing these listicles or these like catchy articles. So as you can see, the red arrow is pointing towards the Philips air purifier in case you want to buy it. But this article is, if you look at the article, it seems like a very intellectual piece. You're talking about studies that talk about air impurities, you're talking about quality of outdoor air, you're talking about why air purifiers are necessary, the problem with Delhi's pollution. So if you read it, you will feel that, okay, this article is coming from a person who's very erudite, who's very knowledgeable about this particular thing. But at the end of the day, you're still fooling people, right? Because you're telling them to buy a particular brand because you have a tie-up and you're getting money from them at the end of the day. So how many of you have tried to read articles recently and closed the article because you were just tired of clicking like close on like advertisements? How many of you have gone through that situation? Most of you, right? So that's the problem. So I used to work at the Economist Group, and the Economist Group earns most of its revenue from advertising. And advertising is unfortunately the business model that most of the media organizations follow. They have advertisers on board with, and Facebook also runs on this model, because of which you mostly see the advertisements on the right-hand corner. Advertising is what runs media, and unfortunately, that's the reason we have all these ads popping up on websites. For digital media, the thing is, it's a lot of people are moving to digital primarily because you can get more views, but it's a catch-22 situation. In print, you have people who want to read genuine news. On digital media, the crowd is very different. On digital media, if you feed people certain kind of news, they will take it. And a lot of things that work are catchy headlines, articles that create a lot of anger, a lot of hatred. These things actually work on digital media. And unfortunately, that's the trend that's being followed by media organizations. So basically, the problem is that the situation that's being created is that now we are in a very difficult situation where you have fake news that is flowing across all platforms. According to a study by IndiaSpend, over 4 in 10 Indians haven't heard of fact-checking organizations. A lot of journalists, to be honest, don't do fact-checking, primarily because they don't have time. You have to bring out an article within like the next 20-25 minutes and populate your website, so you don't have time. Even if you want to do fact-checking, you misquote a lot of people, primarily because you have to get views. So if somebody said, given a particular quote, that's not very problematic, but you make it problematic and put it in your headline so that people click into your article. So the point is not that people, the point is that as journalists and as media organizations, we have a fundamental responsibility to bring to people good news, which is fact-checked, which is genuine, and which is creating a positive impact. That is not happening because people are running after the trend. So there was this one particular study where a man pretended to be ill in front of an underground station in London, and nobody was helping him because everybody was walking by, right? So nobody really wanted to come forward and help that one person. Then one person did it and then everybody came. So that's the situation. We have a herd mentality. So because everybody is doing it, we also want to run in the same direction. And then there are websites like Fair Observer that don't want to do that, but then they face difficulty with getting donors and getting funding. That's the problem that we have. If you see the statistic, this is not updated, but if 33 people were killed in 69 incidents till June 2018, I'm sure there must be more people, and it's already like April. And the number is going to increase. And unfortunately, according to this study, people between the ages of 15 to 20 and 50 above have the least propensity to correctly identify fake news statements. So the thing is that we have a huge population in India that is below 25, that is going to create a massive impact on this country in the coming generations, that is going to vote. And if we have fake news, if we have news around anger that comes around politics, where you motivate people in a certain direction, then yes, we can sway politics in this country. We can sway a lot of things. And of course, this is a quote that was given by Kaushik Basu, who was once the chief economic advisor with the Indian government, who said that, you know, in a nation where politicians thrive on masses being ignorant, media education in general is a very hard task. How do you make people educated? Because they're ignorant in general, and the politicians thrive on it. So, are we doomed? I don't think so. Not necessarily, not yet. We still have some hope. There are still some pragmatists who are present in Indian media organizations who are trying to create an impact, even though their contributions are not being seen because they are not there in the news that much. There are publications like The Ken, The Wire, who are doing extremely good work, and Scroll. But the problem, even Scroll is firing a lot of people. It's doing a lot of cost cutting, primarily because they don't have funding. They're out of funding now. Then there are people who are champagne socialists. Champagne socialist is a term for people who say that, okay, I want to do great things and I want to change the world. But then at the end of the day, they want to sit with a glass of champagne in their hand and talk about like liberal issues, but not really do anything on ground. So I was once at this publication where the founder, who claimed to be a very a person who was giving the youth a space to speak out and changing Indian media in general, and who had a lot of views about communism and the left, and believed that India would be better with a socialist government, once told a few of us off because we did not know that Theobroma is a place where we get good brownies in Mumbai. And we were like, why is this information even relevant? And why is this situation relevant? It's because most people who are running media organizations propagate a certain liberal idea. They want to make you believe that I am this particular person in real life, whereas they are not. They are just trying to come up with the situation. They're treating their employees as people who are easily replaceable. They are propagating views at the workplace which are extremely toxic. Say, for example, if you actually publish an article on the left, they will ask you to remove it immediately, and they will ask you to change stuff in the article, which is highly inappropriate. But these things happen. And the problem is that we need to realize a lot of media organizations that have survived for the last 200 years, like The Economist, have survived because they last on values. They don't last on hypocrisy. They don't last on clickbaity headlines. They are out there because they have a value system. A WSJ is out there because of its value system. If you look at a simple editorial process of The Economist, each article goes through four editorial rounds. That's the amount of editing that goes into it, because everybody is looking at every single fact, every single number. Have you written million instead of billion? That's a very big thing. I did not know that till I joined The Economist Group. For me, if writing a billion, okay, we have a billion people reading this and not a million, it makes a hell lot of a difference. A billion and a million have a lot of zeros in between them. So what can you do? The reason I am reaching out to all of you is because we have elections coming up. We have a generation which needs to understand that we need to question and we need to distinguish between what's right, what's wrong news, because journalism can only survive if the young people are aware of what's good journalism, because otherwise you will end up like what a lot of people like me did. We went into journalism not knowing what it means, what it is, what it stands for, and then we were pushed into doing these kind of things till we came to the realization that, yes, this is wrong, but what do we do about it? We can't do anything about it. Primarily because we don't know how to distinguish between good news and bad news. Because tomorrow, if I want to start a website that does not rely on advertising, that does not rely on catchy headlines, I will probably not survive, because that's how people are surviving in today's world. So yes, you have to learn to question, and you have to understand that media organizations survive because of an ideology. Digital model, a lot of people argue that yes, the digital media model is different, but news is still the same. News doesn't change if you go from print to digital. The news is still going to be the same. Trump is still going to be the president of America, be it in print or in digital. So another thing that we need to understand is we have to give a lot of support to journalists who are doing good work. There are 80,000 newspapers in India, 40% are in Hindi. Massive reader base is in vernacular, and I'm very happy to say this, that a lot of good reporting is happening in vernacular media. Gauri Lankesh, unfortunately, was killed around 2 years ago, did a lot of good work in Kannada, in a Kannada magazine. There was Govind Pansare. There are a lot of other good journalists who are doing good work. But unfortunately, what's happening is because they are reporting for smaller media organizations, and there are not avenues to present Hindi news, say, on digital media, because obviously technical issues. You can't read headlines, you can't read stuff, because you can't migrate from print to digital. So this problem is happening. But a lot of good work is happening in vernacular media. And these vernacular journalists are being targeted for their liberal views, for their views that question the government, that question the society, question religion, question a lot of other things. But they are being targeted, they are being killed, and we are being silent about it. I think it's time we are not silent about these issues, and we are aware of who is doing what, which journalist is doing what kind of reporting, and what reporting is good for us. We have to exercise our own judgment. That is the entire point of receiving an education. So I will open up the floor for questions, and we can talk a little more about journalism and digital media in general. In case you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. Please go ahead. If anybody else has questions. Very good points, and I'll answer your first question. I was not talking about what's morally incorrect, morally correct. I don't think I'm at that stage to talk about it, but yes, there are, listicles are not wrong. What Scoop Poop and BuzzFeed are doing is not wrong, absolutely not. What they are doing is, they're creating stuff for mass consumption, but the problem is that the industry that has come out of it is problematic. Scoop Poop, at one point of time, was not getting a lot of traffic from these articles that they wrote, because everything has an expiry date. People want to read viral articles for one point of time, and after a point of time, they're bored, right? They want to move on to other things. What are those other things is the question. The question is that if you start taking a stand in an ideology and you want to move in a particular direction, we have to move in that particular direction. We cannot change directions. Then we cannot be a media organization or say that we want to be a good media organization. So even though Scoop Poop, BuzzFeed, they have a certain ideology, they don't usually stick to it. So if you go to their social media pages after 10 in the night, you will see the kind of stuff that really works. So the problem is that the kind of ideologies that go into writing these articles, the kind of headlines that we have, it's extremely demeaning towards women. That's something people don't talk about. Why would you want to only objectify women? Because there are a bunch of people who want to read these articles and they give them views. So for views, you're going to compromise on your value systems and on a very basic thing such as feminism. That is the problem. The problem is if you have an article that says, I'm giving a really random example of, say, you know, 10 instances where, say, when the Dadri lynching happened, a lot of articles came out that said 10 instances in India where people were like lynched by mobs or something like that. This is problematic because then you're creating this. If you look at the comments, if you look at the discussions that come out of it, a lot of people pass a lot of hatred. Oh, very good that these guys got lynched. If you eat beef, then you should be killed. And nobody's monitoring them. The fact that we brought up this discussion in the public at a time when you know that people are going to talk only hate and there's going to be a lot of judgment and value according to value systems, why do we do it? That is the question. So we do it primarily because we know that's what works, right? So if people are talking about it, so I'll tell you a typical day in a media organization. You come in, you get to work, and somebody says, oh, okay, so everybody's talking about this thing, but you know, these websites have already written an article about this thing. What do we do differently? Okay, let's pick up these 10 things and write about it and, you know, put it out at this point of time, whether there'll be a lot of readers, and then we'll get a lot of clicks, and then we'll show to our investors that we've got so many clicks on our articles. That's what the problem is. My problem is I'm not passing a value judgment on the fact that there shouldn't be listicles, there shouldn't be entertainment articles. Of course there should be entertainment articles. But why demean women? That is the question. The second one, so your second question was on advertisements, right? The advertising model in general, the reason it's become a menace is because of social media, because of Facebook, Google ads, not to a certain extent Twitter, mobile applications. If you read in shorts, at one point of time when it started, it had news. Now you will just swipe at least 3 advertisements before you get to the next story. The problem is that when these mobile apps, these websites start doing well, a lot of people are reading it, and then a lot of people have certain expectations from the app. But the problem is, instead of monitoring, it's very simple. Just send out a survey to your users and ask them, what do you want to read? What do you like to like about our app? What do you don't like about our app? But no, people don't do that. People look at what competitors are doing. How are they getting the numbers? Okay, let us also get the numbers by doing the same thing and compromising on our values for which we stood up in the first place. Why should we do that? That Philips article that I showed you is of a website that claims to give the youth a platform to talk about issues that matter to them. That basically takes a stand for LGBT rights, for women, for a lot of other things. But that at the end of the day, they have no problem with tying up and promoting one particular company. That is also a problematic discourse. Why are you making people believe that there's this one air purifier out there? And why do we need air purifiers? It's a whole debate. There are a lot of things that come up when I'm talking about these things. The problem is nobody's asking these questions. That's where the frustration is. And in terms of advertising, yes, you can click one ad and get over with it. But when you open a website, say for paywalls, this is a question we frequently ask the Economist editors. Why do we have a paywall? We have a paywall because if you look at the crowd that reads The Economist, it's not people who are of your age. They're people who are much older, in their 30s, who want to read such articles. We read The Economist when we are in college because we get easy access to it. Once we leave college, I'm betting on this, nobody reads The Economist. The crowd that reads The Economist is very different. So that's the reason they have a paywall, because people are willing to pay that much money to read The Economist.
So, that kind of happens when you have a site which caters to Even if it is a non-profit, you still need them operating them. Right? So these are just ways to go about it. But and you know, general assumption that advertisements creates issues. Yes, of course it creates issues, but is there really any other way to do it?
Well, there are tons of ways. I mean, you can look at the way I mean, imagine campuses in the US have banned Coca-Cola on the campus. Mm-hmm. Right? Coke is not being sold. I think in our campus we do serve soft drinks.
No, we don't know.
But you know, you can say there are ways. Some universities think that we are losing a lot of revenue by doing it or not. I don't think she's saying advertisements are bad or wrong or whatever. It's like junk food, right? Is it okay or not? Your call. But should we proliferate junk food so that that's the only thing that is available? So the question is how much this, that, whatever, it's all gray area. It's not right or wrong. But at the same time, imagine if every single food that you eat is junk food. Right, 99% of it, anything that you buy from outside, anything, I mean, I'm talking about the US, it is genetically, 99% of it is genetically modified food. Is that okay? We don't know. But should we do that? It's a question that you have to answer. So it's not right or wrong. It's something that we should be aware of. Look, these are ads that are happening. This is junk food that is being, humko bolte thodi hai ki ye kharido, lekin jab kuch milta hi nahi hai, 132 types of pizza sauces that you can buy in a 132 types of pizza, not pizza, pasta toppings. I mean, do you need 132?
And to that,
you say, no law is being broken. But is that what we should do? We have to think. Your call. Your answer will be different.
Yeah, and also in terms of positing advertisements. So you, when you are coding on WordPress, you have the opportunity to put less ads. You can put an ad at the top, you can put an ad at the bottom, but people go crazy with advertisements because obviously they want more investors on board. So the question is, you need to decide what do you stand for. If you're saying I stand for liberal ideas, socialist ideas, I have a problem with this one particular company. I write an article one fine day talking about how Unilever is polluting the canals, polluting the rivers in Kodai Kanara. The next fine day, I see an article about you collaborating with Unilever to publish an article about one of their products. What kind of
Made a film on that, right? This young girl made a film.
Yes. Sophia Ashraf made a film on that. So, if you have published an article like that, where you talk about Unilever doing that, and everybody's talking about, oh, Unilever's this, Unilever's that, next fine morning, you tie up with the same Unilever to do something. You're going against your own value system. That means you don't have a value system.
IT Madras collaborated. She was at IT Madras.
I think so, yes. That's what I'm saying. We have to bring about this element of questioning in our discourse. Like if I'm reading an in shorts, and it's also about competition, right? At the end of the day, the person who can pay gets their ads out there, and obviously their products thrive, and they're killing competition also at the end of the day. That is also another problem that's coming up. So if you have an insurance where you have like, there was this one particular survey that was done by a dating app using one of these websites, where the problem that happened at the end of the day was you just knew the name of one dating app. So everybody was using that same dating app. Nobody used the new ones. And then you had new competitors coming in and then nobody was going on those websites. So the thing is, you have to choose your battles and fight them very wisely. Either you choose to ally with the corporates, or you choose to be a liberal and you have socialist leanings, but you have to decide where you are. Or you choose to be an organization like Fair Observer, where you would choose to not go with the advertising model, but you want to get crowdsourced funding. You go without, you stick to one particular ideal where people come on board, they write a certain level of articles of a certain depth, a certain quality, and you don't compromise on that. There's a lot of sacrifice that comes with it, but people are willing to do it. People are not willing to do it in India, very unfortunately.
Why don't our
or mainstream media hasn't courage to question ground issues of the people in this case. When even the interviews post to our prime minister and things like that, that happened in the second question is that I was actually working on some sort of campaign program of our prime minister. Very put every night and he would like to speak about fashion tickets, about Nehru and some sort of stuff. So I actually came across the student tax later through the wire. So why won't our mainstream media also actually do fact checking and get back to people that yes, this is wrong?
Because second question, that's a very simple answer, is Indian people don't care, they don't ask. They just need
I have a problem with that. That was my question. And you keep saying about tier 2 to tier 3 cities in India. If I largely look at things, I see the same thing happening in the US. I mean, similar things. So I don't agree with the India label comment or Indian population or tier 2 to tier 3. Same thing is happening over there.
Actually, in the US, let's talk about
it. It might be even worse.
No. Let's talk about the US because I know the US fair bit. I've had how many visitors? 5 American visitors in the last few days. The US, officially, there are 6 jobs in public relations for every job in journalism. Officially. The reality is the number is more 10-1. What you get in New York Times when it comes to foreign affairs is propaganda and bullshit. Invariably negative stories about not just India, but Kenya. The New York Times correspondent will fly into Delhi. There was a complete muppet who had been reporting on health. He swam for the Yale swim team, and all of a sudden, overnight, he somersaulted into an India expert. Flies in here, starts reporting about India, and then flies back. And you see that across the board in US media, and you see that in domestic news. In the US, even the so-called good publications, Wall Street Journal, people are leaving it. Why? Because it's now owned by Rupert Murdoch, who also owns Fox News. Fox News. All right, not studio. Get your facts right. Okay? So, Murdoch owns Wall Street Journal. Sulzberger's own New York Times.
Jeff Bezos
owns Washington Post. And Washington Post will never talk much about Amazon's monopoly or Jeff Bezos' sex life, which is very interesting and has ramifications beyond his sex life. So the point is that if you look at US media, I certainly agree with Manish. US media is downright awful. It is commercial, it is concentrated, it is polarized, and it has pioneered clickbait. What is BuzzFeed? It is a US publication. And if you look at the Indian digital media, India is importing the US digital media model. What is Scroll? Well, Scroll is funded by a media network. What is The Wire? Again, funded by the US, which is, yeah, fine, but even The Wire is not very good at fact check. We've checked them. They changed an article and didn't say they changed it. Quartz India. Or let's talk about Bloomberg Quint. Right now, what you're getting in India is a complete colonization of the Indian mind. Absolute colonization of the Indian mind by the Americans. All the young read American-funded Indian channels, and then they go to this bloody, what's this bullshit thing? No. Twitter, of course, is again American-owned, and they make money. Facebook is again American-owned. WhatsApp is again American-owned. But this thing that's very popular, the questioning thing, Quora, which is ridiculously popular amongst the Indians, which is run by people I know in Silicon Valley. And for me, the reality is it's not necessarily an Indian problem. It is an American problem exported to India and amplified in India. And we have completely lost our senses. Because at the end of the day, good media depends on two things. One is demand and two is supply. You've got to have demand for a good publication where people want to learn something. And two, you need people who are capable of providing it. And in India, both sides are largely broken. Same as in America, same as in Italy.
But the vernacular media is not that broken, to be honest. I think the vernacular media in India is definitely doing great work. Unfortunately, the problem is that they do not get much traction and people do not read them because...
or the people who matter don't read.
Yeah, people
matter. The numbers are still hard for vernacular.
The numbers
yeah,
are very
yeah.
high.
Yeah.
I don't know if you said there are technical issues. I don't know how much of a technical issue really there is. I mean, imagine all the articles in whatever Japanese or German or Italian or whatever are written in their languages. Today, everything is Unicode. I can pretty much just copy paste. The fact that I do not choose to speak in Hindi or read in Hindi is the problem. It is not about the technical problem. Agar main Hindi mein baat karun, toh main kam samajhta hun apne aap ko. Aur aap bhi kam samajhta. You also think me I'm less. And that's why it propagates. It is not technical issue in itself. Hum padhna nahi chahte, hum bolna nahi chahte.
And unfortunately, vernacular journalists are also the ones who are targeted the most by fundamentalists.
Because they write local. See, for me, most important news is Gandhinagar mein kya hua. It is very important for me because I go running every morning. I am not kidding, it is important for me. I don't care about what happened in Italy to Berlusconi's whatever, Hitler ki mar gayi, whatever happened, right?
So we were having this conversation in one of my previous jobs where I asked that why don't we write more articles that often in Hindi? Because there's such a big readership base, right? 40% of print newspapers are in Hindi. So I was told that firstly I didn't know anything. I was 22 back then and I used to be okay with such statements, but I was told I don't know anything. And second thing was that when you publish Hindi articles on the URL, you have to write a corresponding thing in English. And the problem is that it becomes very difficult to search on Google. So at the end of the day, you will not get clicks anyway. And if you have that in Hindi, then obviously the article, the URL won't work. You can't migrate when you're upgrading your website. So there are these technical issues that the
site
cannot.
This is where technical colleges like IIT or somebody amongst the student community should take note. बहुत बड़ी population है जो पढ़ती है. I remember my grandmother कितना धीरे पढ़ती थी, पर हिंदी का अखबार यानी अमर उजाला, the local section, every single thing she would read because that is the story that matters to her. Everything that happened in that city, absolutely important. Right? दिल्ली में हुआ होगा, उसके बाद और किसी देश में हुआ होगा, who cares? But if so, for instance, this issue, right, of for you to put that in and nobody will click, whatever. Slowly, my relative, 60-year-old, they don't have much to do. But if they sort of, they are good with WhatsApp, right? So imagine somehow they can be good with searching things on the internet, read whatever in Hindi. Somebody provides that platform. It's a great thing to sort of come up with whatever that platform might be.
It is increasing. The amount of vernacular media in the internet is increasing. Some of the most major publications now having Hindi edition. The Wire is starting in Urdu, if I remember.
It's increasing, but there's not many people who want to associate with it, primarily because India has this massive theme of log kya kahenge, social status, and English is unfortunately given a social status. So there was this one time when Dainik Jagran was holding a very big event and they wanted young people to write stories in Hindi, and they said we will publish this in our newspaper. And they approached me and he told me that they had found in a population of 1.3 billion people, how many people did they find who wanted to write an article for Dainik Jagran? Just stick a word.
10.
3. They found just 3 young people who wanted to write that two fiction stories in Hindi, not even a news, hardcore news. Like I wasn't told to go out on the street and report ki kiske ghar mein chori hui hai. No. I was asked if I want to write a fiction story, even a poem would work, but they found just 3 people. So even though they have a digital presence, there are not many people who want to read them. And even though they're doing good work, good journalism, the problem with India is obviously it's an American, English is a British export, and we unfortunately... And when Gauri Lankesh passed away, a lot of people who actually protested against that entire thing were leaders and were not from the young people. Even the young people who were part of that entire narrative of talking about Gauri Lankesh. I wrote an article for Fair Observer, and one of the biggest things that came out was that everybody was talking about Gauri Lankesh, nobody knew what she writes about. Nobody has written any of her articles. Nobody knows, they just on the bandwagon because we have to protest against the government, we have to take a stand, and we have JNU ke hai, or there are some people in JNU are taking a standard against a certain thing, so everybody is doing it, let us also do it. So that's how the problem is, right? Why don't we have this ability to question? Why don't we have this ability to, you know, say, okay, this one particular journalist has passed away. What did they write about? What did they actually do that created such a stir? Among, why do we just jump on the liberal bandwagon just because it's good in America and in other, you know, other places?
I have a question. So I just want to understand when you say that some of the news is being fed to the user by the media groups, but is it really true? And doesn't that happen that as a user, I want to read certain kind of things, and therefore the media is, you know, choosing to write about it? So is there really a clear relation here that since I prefer this kind of news as a user, and therefore the media is writing about it, and therefore it is just proliferating?
Yeah, that's the logic that's being used to write a certain kind of article, but the thing is, patriarchy's been around for centuries. Sexism's been around for centuries. Is it okay? People want to talk about it. People want to watch movies like Tarka Pachnama. Is it okay? It's not. Because at the end of the day, it's a value system, right? Sexism is not okay. But there are people who want to read about it, and there are people who are willing to write about it just because they want to get the number. Nobody ever goes out and says, oh, listen, this is wrong and we are not going to do it. And if every publication starts doing that, people will stop being sexist. But that's not happening.
Somebody has to draw a line. I think the question is good. Whether who proliferates, there is no clear answer. But I'll give you an example of this company called Frito-Lay's. Have you heard about this largest chips company? They have 160, or maybe I'll send you that article. It's called the whatever of junk food. They have 600 PhDs working in that company. 600 PhDs.
McDonald's.
So forget, I mean, this is what I read. What they work on is that something called the satiation enzyme, which is basically once you pop, you can't stop, right? So imagine you are eating, and you know somehow I stop your enzyme going to your brain so that you don't even know whether you're full or not, and so that you keep on, you know, feeding yourself. And so they figured out that these three things, salt, sugar, and fat, are these three things which basically charge up, you know, your system, which stops all of that. So there are 600 people working on figuring out how to make people eat more, right? And so it's the same thing, right? How do you draw a line whether it is right or wrong? They figure out that 1.1 pound per square inch of pressure on the chips so that it breaks by your tongue activates that enzyme or whatever, right? And so, you know, now they'll work on making sure that it is just exactly whatever so that you keep on eating. And the way I'm trying to relate to your question is that there is no right answer, right? But some, should we break this or not?
So I ask this because I also think that's very similar to what we do in education institutes, right? As a institution, should we be imparting education what we feel is right to the student community? Or should we figure out what is right for them from their end, and then we should impart it?
And I think this is both related. If we keep on feeding junk food, they'll probably think that junk food is okay. So how do I say what is?
Let me also give you another example. A lot of memes are also created. So this isn't tied in media, but there's a very classic example of how the Native Americans were actually destroyed by the white Americans. How? By involving them in casinos, by involving them with alcohol. And the thing was, when you took away their land, and then at the end of the day, they went to they were given casinos and gambling, and they all got involved, and they thought it was okay, and there was nobody to tell them that it wasn't, and the entire population is literally destroyed. And they were obviously wiped out before, but they were wiped out again by this need that was created. Even if you go in India, in certain areas, a need has been created to, so let's talk about feminism. There's a need that has been created to diss feminism, because obviously there are some people like a Kamala Bhasin or somebody, and there are the issues like Me Too that have come up, and then people are saying there's this trajectory, people are saying, okay, so women are just making use of these hashtags to subjugate some innocent men. Okay, for a few women have done it, not everybody has done it, but media organizations are playing on the sentiment and they're publishing articles about it. The Me Too movement died out in India because at the end of the day, everybody filled in on this need to prove that, oh, women are incorrect. So let's just, feed onto this entire belief system. So sometimes needs are also created. So we can't really assume that audience wants something. As I said, a very simple thing we can do is to send out a survey.
Yeah, something like celebrities, who is wearing what to airports? Nobody wants to. But still, that is interesting.
Yeah.
That
but
is
what do you mean nobody wants to? Yeah.
Just hold fire. Let me ask you a simple question. What gets more views on YouTube? A song of a Bollywood song of a girl in skimpy clothing? Or a brilliant analysis of a leading economist? No, answer me the question.
Song.
All right? Let me finish this line of argument or a question. Ipso facto, should all of us just produce more and more songs of girls in skimpy clothing? Why not?
Yeah, correct. Should we stop producing songs with girls in skimpy
clothing? No, you.
I did not ask you that question.
You have to decide.
No. Hold fire. Have I given you a Judeo-Christian injunction? I've asked you a question. Should we just produce? I have not talked about prohibition. You are. You're talking like a mullah or a padri. You are, or a Brahmin. One of the three. Who are you? Who are you to prohibit anything? Can you do it? How do you prohibit anything? You need a sword or an implementation mechanism or a lockup mechanism. Okay, so I'm not saying should we prohibit. I'm not at all getting there. I'm asking you a very simple question about supply. Should you, Siddharth, as an individual with some free will, go around Ahmedabad and find a pretty girl and convince her to take her clothes off and then film her? Yes, no. And just do that and nothing else.
I have an example from my time at Start TV Network when I started off as a broadcast journalist. One of my first meetings was with Ekta Kapoor. And the first question, we were 21 year olds, very young, and we had this entire TV change kar denge, serials change kar denge. So we had this conversation with her. She enlightened us on why she did the work that she did. Because she said that I did it once, everybody liked it, I did it again, people liked it, now I do it all the time. So the thing is, the problem is now, women in many small places, like I was sent for a research project in Seho, which is a very small place near Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh. I was sent there by my manager because I went and told him, "Ye rishta kya kehta hai? Rubbish hai." So he said, "Why don't you go on a research trip?" So when I went there and I talked to those women, for them, their idea of empowerment was akshara from ye rishta kehlata hai, because she cooks, takes care of her husband, takes care of her children, goes to work, takes care of her sasasur. Basically, she's a superwoman. So they said that that's their idea of feminism. That's the idea that they had about what, you know, like what how women should be. And when I came back, a few of us decided to work on a project where we showed, we tried to work on a different kind of show, where we showed women to be slightly different, little more independent, and not so gharelu, not with guntas and everything. It didn't work. Nobody watched it. Primarily because nobody's done it before, right? Nobody started to do it. Everybody's just going with the normal route. That's what works. So, but then people like Ekta Kapoor don't want to change their ways too, because they think that I don't want to fail. I have a particular formula that works. That's how media is in general.
Two comments, right? One, of course, interesting story about this guy called Anam Gandhi, who wrote Ekta Kapoor. All his serials were written by this guy. Never went to college. I spent almost 8 hours talking to him. He wrote Ekta Kapoor serial. He also made Ship of Theseus.
Yes.
I mean, the best movie I have ever seen. And then of course he made this Arvind Kejriwal scene.
And he runs a startup.
And he wanted our lab to go there and visit. He does this movie.
Augmented reality.
Augmented reality startup. Absolutely brilliant man. And he talks about the need. And maybe we can talk later. That the need of, people are going to watch all of that. People are going to watch She was thesis made a lot of money because it was made with very little budget and it was super blockbuster with a 6x the money. But people want to watch. So for if you have a message to send, you will have to sort of package it as you know, something interesting, some interesting story, which is what you know, he tried to do in Chicago. Otherwise it won't sell. Second, I also feel sometimes that this I mean, it's not a question or comment, so I don't want to talk on the so maybe others can talk and we can talk over it. But I had an issue with this other side also. There is this one notion of non-Gharelu type woman, and there is this notion of Gharelu type. And it's just like, you know, there is this man who either is a farmer or not a farmer. Like we had in our workshop, there was this huge discussion once on whether there was this huge thing that happened recently where PM said that Pakode Vishna hai or something like that, right? It became a big deal. And we had this discussion among our teachers whether Pakode Vishna galat cheez hai, kharaab cheez hai, right? Is it bad to sell pakoda to earn your living or whatever you were doing, or you know, whatever? And something, some sort of those things have to happen and things have to start happening. Those questions have to be asked. Right or wrong? I'm not saying right or wrong. Whether we should do it or not, your own call, right? But you know. Should we have that?
Yeah, so my point is that we have to strike a balance somewhere. If you are, if you have a view of a woman being a particular, you know, thing, why does an ideal woman have to be someone who's a superwoman who's doing everything at once? The point is that nobody's question, bringing up these questions. Nobody, when I went to that village, the thing that stood out for me for them, yes, their girls had started wearing jeans because somebody in Syria wore it. So yes, that impact was there. So I'm not denying that these serials or these shows don't have an impact. They do. A lot of the women, they send their girls to study engineering or to other colleges because they saw some other girl following her dreams in a serial. So these things are there. But then there's also this problematic discourse of this woman.
And then that is not right. I mean, let's not put sending their girls to doing engineering or whatever is something which is great or whatever, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that is what is coming out. वो भी बहुत अच्छी चीज़ नहीं है. सारे इंजीनियर आजकल खाली बैठे हैं. वही कोई बहुत अच्छी चीज है कि जमीन बेचकर बच्चे को 12 लाख रुपए में इंजीनियरिंग करा दी. बहुत अच्छा काम तो नहीं करा क्योंकि इंजीनियर हमारी बच्ची व्हाटएवर दैट सी इज.
I was also having a chat with Ashwita Shetty from the Bodhi Tree Foundation. He said that a very fundamental problem is among the rural youth that there is very little awareness. They don't know anything apart from what they like. What is your saying? They basically hear that okay, this person has gone there, so this college is good. So they see these advertisements of these amity and all.
And I have a problem with when you say rural. I think that's the problem everywhere. Let's not. That's why. I mean, if we talk to children here or students here, I would probably make the same thing.
Yeah, I mean, look, is Delhi better? Is DPS better?
DPS,
it's the same factory.
Rural. Why? I mean, here.
Correct.
This campus. I think we all do exactly the same thing. Why become rural youth?
Correct.
It's just like wo taadi peete hain ya hum rum 3 peete hain. That's all.
Correct.
Yeah. I mean, look, what is DPS? It's a factory. It's a factory. What do most people do when they graduate?
Sochta hai. Aap 15 se 20 ki jo baat kar rahe hain, wo isliye kyunki hamare paas time hi nahi hai. Nick KR ki ek workshop hoti hai San Francisco mein. $1,900, one day workshop, how to make apps sticky, gets told in 5 minutes. 5 minutes mein 1000 log register kar lete hain ki kaise hum apni apps sticky banaye taki ek bar once you pop you can stop. So you know, of course we will not have time to keep shorts hai na, 3 minute mein sab chahiye in shorts. So I think the problem is somewhere else. I mean, the good thing is if we are aware, and are we aware,
probably the answers will come.
Any questions?
Actually, I have a question with regards to Pranjay Guho from the US, he was in EPW, right? Then he had to be, and I read somewhere that it was because he had written an article about Amani.
And the Adani's.
Adani. Who? So,
the Adani group.
Who left, sir? So I don't know whether is that credible news or
it is credible news. There's a very famous interview of Poronjoy with The Wire. You can go through it. Where he's talked about what happened. there are two things that have happened. The first thing that has happened is this incident is about a very famous journalist, Poronjoy Guha Thakurta. He's a very senior journalist who's done a lot of reporting, particularly reports on the crony capitalism, the corporates. So he wrote this very scathing article on the Adani Group, and he had hit the problem the Adani Group had with that article was that they said it was not fact-checked, that they were not contacted before the scathing article was written. I think Poronjoy had accused the Adani Group of colluding with the Modi government to, escape some taxes. And that article was taken off by APW, and a meeting was called where Mr. Thakurta was told that he would have to take out the article, and from now on, everything he writes will be reviewed by an internal committee. And the internal committee that had called that meeting had people as famous as the historian Romila Thapar. And this was told to him. And he said that no, I would rather resign. Now the problem is, if you look at the article, these are very scathing allegations. These allegations are there against almost every corporate. It's not every corporate in India has done something or the other to escape taxes. Let's just be honest about it. There are two problems over here. The first problem is the fact that Adani said that they haven't fact-checked. So we might have to believe that too, that they probably didn't send out a mail to the Adanis. The second point is that we have this group of liberals who are on a board of a very famous academic publication getting together under pressure, I don't know from the government or who or readers or whatever, telling one particular journalist from now on we have to get your articles reviewed. So the problem is, at the end of the day, we can't give journalists complete freedom. We don't give journalists complete freedom, primarily because what do you know about fact checking? You have these accusations, you have these people coming up and saying the fact-checking wasn't done. So then the problem that comes up is, are we giving justice to the people? We are not giving them the right news. But then the publications don't want to publish it. So it's a cash 22 situation. A publication is liberal only to the extent somebody doesn't put pressure on it. Or somebody doesn't come and say that, okay, we're keeping our wings for now. Rupert Murdoch will let the WSG fly till the one day they write something scathing about Fox News. And their wings will be clipped and they will be told to, stop writing articles about Fox News. So the thing is, what we have to understand is, if you want to make a difference to journalism, or you want to be a Poronjoy Guha Thakurta, either you take the high road where you say I resign, and then you become a freelance writer and then you do freelance work. A lot of people are not willing to do that, because then you lose a bit of a reputation. Then you are a freelance writer, right? You don't have a stable income. But then if you stick to these organizations, you'll have to follow their rules. But the problem is, who sets these rules? Who is the person who sets the rules? Why are we not asking these questions? And the problem is, EPW could get away with it because nobody else questioned. It's only after he resigned that we started questioning, why did he resign? And very few people know about this. Because how many people read Poronjoy Guha Thakurta? Let's be honest. How many people know?
And
one
of the most striking things is that
so if you have a particular ideology, say I am a left liberal, but I'm still running a media publication, right? So my journalists have the authority to write on issues that are not in conjunction with my views. That is the entire point of journalism. If I say that I don't support the Congress, I can give somebody has the right to publish an article supporting Modi if it's fact-checked, it's correct, and it's saying the right things. But don't compromise on your value system. There's a difference between political views, there's a difference between values and like morals. It's a very distinguishable thing. That's what I'm trying to say. Where do we draw the line? Thanks everyone for coming today and hearing me out. And all the best to all of you for the year ahead. If you have any more questions, then please feel free to drop me a mail or ask me.